safety and public health teams. We will provide a brief update and then take your questions. Let me start by addressing what happened in our community over the weekend. On Saturday night, an 11-year-old, Davon McNeil, was shot and killed while standing outside after a community cookout. We're all heartbroken and saddened and outraged. All of us are praying for Davon's mother and his entire family. We're joined this afternoon by Davon's grandfather, John Ayala, a friend of the District of Columbia. This is just an unimaginable tragedy for any family to go through, and I know that Davon and his family in this moment of grief want to make sure that another family doesn't suffer this tragic loss. So while we are all prayerful for them, we also need to work together to hold the people who killed Davon accountable. This should not have happened, and it cannot keep happening. We can't keep losing our children to senseless gun violence. I'm asking all who know anything about the shooting that killed Davon to contact us immediately. The anonymous tip line can be reached by texting 50411, 50411, or calling 202-727-9099. And there is a $25,000 reward for information that leads to an arrest in this case. Sadly, Davon was not the only life we lost over the weekend to senseless gun violence. And Chief Newsham will provide us a more fulsome update in just a few moments. But before we do that, I want to also report out on our latest information on the district's response to COVID-19. Today, this morning, we announced 33 new cases. And two more Washingtonians have lost their life due to this virus. We want everyone to be mindful of their own behavior. If you're feeling sick, obviously stay home. Don't go around anybody and get tested and isolate until you know the results of your test. Wear a mask. Continue to social distance and continue to practice good hand hygiene. And remember to ask yourself this question when leaving the house, and that is, do I need to be there? Do I need to be going where I'm going? We continue to make free testing available in the district, and we put out on coronavirus.dc.gov a little flashcard to help people know all of the locations where they can get tested at a district-supported site during this week. So please pay attention to coronavirus.dc.gov. And with that, I'm going to ask the chief to begin our public safety update. We're also joined by Dale McFadden, who is the director of the Office of Neighborhood Safety and Engagement. And then we will take your questions related to public safety and public health.
Thank you, Mayor Bowser. I'm Pete Newsham. I'm the Chief of Police for the Metropolitan Police Department. We did have, as the mayor mentioned, three homicides this weekend. I'll go through them and give you as many details as I have at this point. On Friday at about 11, a little after 11 p.m., closer to 11:15, members of the 6th District were in the area of the 1900 block of 18th Street Southeast when they heard multiple gunshots. They located a crime scene in front of an apartment building. There was a female victim a short distance away, and she was suffering from gunshot wounds. She was transported to a local hospital where all life-saving efforts failed, and she was pronounced dead. She has been identified as a 20-year-old Jordan Simmons of Hyattsville, Maryland. A second victim was located a few blocks away with a gunshot wound to the arm, which we believe is non-life threatening. The preliminary information we have on this case so far is that there was some kind of a dispute regarding somebody who had parked in a way that others were uncomfortable with in the area. At least two shooters opened fire on the vehicle, and as a result of that shooting, Jordan lost her life. We believe that Jordan was not the intended target in this shooting. The mayor talked a little bit about Davon, and I'm going to give you the details on that homicide. On July 4th, just around 9:20 in the evening, 7th District officers were in the 1400 block of Cedar Street Southeast. They were flagged down by a citizen in reference to a shooting that had just occurred. They found a juvenile victim who has been identified as 11-year-old Davon McNeil. He was lying just outside of his home. He was in his mother's arms, and he was suffering from a fatal gunshot wound. As the mayor said, we want to express our sincere condolences to Davon's mom, to Davon's family. I can't imagine what it would be like to hold your 11-year-old son in your arms as he's losing his life. We have some of the best detectives in the Metropolitan Police Department that are assigned to this case, and have made significant progress. We intend to hold all of the suspects that are responsible for this little boy's death accountable for their actions. In Ward 6, we had another tragic homicide that occurred a little bit before 11 p.m. on July 4th. This was a little bit after Davon had lost his life. It was at the McDonald's in the 1500 block of Pennsylvania Avenue Southeast. When we arrived on the scene, we found an adult male who was unconscious, suffering from gunshot wounds. He was transported to a local hospital where he was pronounced dead. He has been identified as 36-year-old Antonio Gardner of Oxon Hill, Maryland. The preliminary information that we have in this case is there was a disturbance inside of the McDonald's. We believe fireworks were shot off inside of the McDonald's. We believe that Mr. Gardner was a patron of the McDonald's at the time. When he went outside to see what was going on, he ended up getting shot, and those gunshots took his life. Again, we have made significant progress in this case, and we anticipate that we will bring this to a swift closure. That's all I have with regards to public safety updates, Mayor, and we can turn it over for any questions that you all might have.
Any questions? Yes, Sam.
Mayor, I just wanted to ask him that. We'd heard that the mother was a violence interrupter.
Yes. So Davon's mom is working as a violence interrupter for one of our contractors that is contracted through Dale's office.
Could he tell us something about
it? Sure.
So Ms. McNeil is really dedicated to that community, Cedar Gardens and Butler Gardens. She was out there. I was out there twice in the day checking on the various priority communities to make sure that everything was in place. And so she's extremely dedicated to that community. Her son was actually helping her with the peace cookout. There were a list of agreements about not being on social media, small group of individuals. There were at least 20 kids out there, and my understanding is that this took place after the event. And so we're going to continue, the mayor's office, we're going to continue to support Ms. McNeil and her family and this situation. This young man's name would not go in vain. So we're going to do whatever we can do to support this community in a time of need. A lot of people are mourning right now because of the death of this young man who had so much potential. And I had the opportunity to meet with him an hour before this situation took place.
So Ms. McFadden, was this your event? Was it a violence interrupter event?
So as you know, we contract with three contractors. We have 21 priority communities, and they had different events. They had retreats. So some of the communities were out overnight on retreats. And this was an event put on by the violence interrupter and the community This is what the community asked for. It wasn't just the young man, it was also the elders in the community that cooked food and were out there. It was not a large gathering at all. It was really a collective a group as far as the community involved and organizations to put this event on for the community. And they abide by everything that we ask, small groups, not being on social media, and agreement to peace during that time. And as I stated, this situation took place after the peace cookout.
Yes,
Senator. Is there any reason to believe that the shooting was related to Crystal McNeil's work with Violence Interrupter?
No, not at all. MPD is investigating.
Hold on. Okay. You can come to the mic if you want.
We don't have any information to suggest that.
Chief, while you're there, you put out some video last week, I think it was Thursday, of an incident, as I recall, June 26th. Same block, the video shows guys getting out of a car and shooting in every direction. Is that linked to this, you think?
It could very well be. That's why we had police officers in the area. And we've had police officers all throughout historic Anacostia when we've seen the uptick in violence over there.
Any indication of what kind of beef, if you will, is going on in that neighborhood?
I can tell you this, Sam, we will get to the bottom of it, and a lot of that information will come forth in the charging documents.
Stephanie. Chief, can you discuss, you said that there was progress made. Is there anything you can talk about in that area, and also why canines were on scene yesterday?
Why canines were on the scene? It's not unusual to have canines do follow-up for forensic evidence that we might not have been able to locate during that evening. So whenever we have an investigation, if we gather additional details that would require follow-up by K-9 to find forensic evidence, we'll do that. Yes?
Chief, do you have any update on the shooting this morning in the 2400 block of MLK Southeast?
I was alerted to that since I've been here in the Wilson building, so we do have a very serious shooting working right now on Martin Luther King at the intersection of Talbert. I know it's an adult male, or at least he's been described as an adult male, who's in very serious condition. Yes.
What hospitals were each of the victims taken to?
What hospital?
You said they were taken to, each of the victims were taken to local hospitals.
Yeah, we never discussed the location of the hospital. I apologize. Yes.
Do you have any more details on the arrests related to the July 4th protests?
We had four arrests during the 4th of July weekend. One of those arrests was particularly concerning to us. It was a person that we've arrested a couple of other times down in that same area. That person was given a stay-away order from the area. When the police located him down here, they attempted to make an arrest again. He ended up very seriously biting one of our police officers. We also had a threats arrest. We had a CPWL arrest. And we had a leaving after colliding DUI arrest in the area. Whether or not it's related to the protests remains to be seen. Yes.
Do you have any more information on the 33-year-old man that was killed due to the fireworks incident?
Ooh, very sad. Yeah, that happened up in Northwest. I believe it was in the 800 block of Longfellow Street Northwest. And we had, this just goes to show you how extremely dangerous some of these commercial grade fireworks can be. He was working with some fireworks. He ends up setting, and it was illegal, of course, to have those fireworks here in our city. Working with the fireworks went off, and he suffered a very traumatic injury to his head, which ended up resulting in his death. The death has been ruled accidental.
Mayor Bowser, tomorrow is the deadline for taking action on the emergency police reform legislation passed by the council. What are you planning on doing with that legislation, and why did you wait the whole 10-day period to take action?
They're very serious issues in that bill, Fennett, and I have to make sure I understand all of them and their implications for public safety. So I will act tomorrow. Yes?
Mayor, I spoke with the family of Devon. Obviously, we have a family member here as well, and they have said that you called and spoke with the mother, among other people. And there's also others who are mothers and victims of young kids in D.C. who died before. And they were saying that this was really a first, that they had not received a call from you. The family of Devon is incredibly grateful for you reaching out. Can you talk to us about why you did?
Well, I can certainly tell you it's not a first, so I don't know who would have told you that.
Well, I was told the mother of Makiya Wilson did not get a call.
Oh, she most certainly did.
Okay.
Did Micaiah Wilson's mother tell you that?
Can I ask you?
Can you answer that question? Did she tell you that?
I can't answer that question.
You can answer it. Did she tell you that or not?
I want to get into a back and forth. I'd like to ask.
Okay, let me, because you just said something that that has to be corrected. And I can't believe that Micaiah Wilson's mother told you that. So you're giving secondhand information to your listeners that's just wrong, and it's not right.
And I appreciate you correcting that. That's my job to ask questions.
But just say if Micaiah Wilson's mother told you that, or if you're spreading a rumor.
May I ask you, Mayor, the family of Devon, one of the things that was said is that they want to see more violent interrupters. We understand that the budget calls for about 800, more than 800,000 less to the program. Are you planning to change that? And what was some of the message, if you can, to some of the communication that was sent to the family yesterday, and why you reached out?
Well, let me just be clear, Stephanie, that any time, and the reason why I responded to you the way that I did is because when people are so raw and emotional and hurt, not just Crystal, not just Devon's mother, but people are hurting when they see a child senselessly killed in our city. And they want answers. Sometimes people want revenge, which we're also very concerned about. People want it just to stop. And sometimes they think I can make it stop, the police chief can make it stop, a violence interrupter can make it stop. And to have this confluence of having an event sponsored by violence interrupters, have the child of a violence interrupter killed. So are you suggesting to me that there's some magic answer that's reflected in my budget? I wish there were. Will there be a magic answer reflected in the budget the council approves? Probably not. But it all makes us feel powerless to stop gun violence. And that's what we have to fight against, feeling powerless to stop gun violence. We have to make sure that we're using every tool at our disposal to stop people who would be willing to do this. So I was thinking about this today. We're dealing with a response to a health pandemic, to demonstrations brought on by outrage of an American being killed on the streets, representative of other Americans killed on the streets. And now we see our kids killing each other. Over what? I guarantee you when they find out what this is about, it's gonna be about nothing. It's going to be about absolutely nothing. So the other like epidemic that we have to respond to is this sense of hopelessness of kids with guns that will kill other kids. So when I spoke to Crystal and I spoke to John and his wife, all I can really say is how sorry I am. How sorry I am that they lost this bright, beautiful boy who should be doing what 11 years olds are doing. That's what he should be doing. And because somebody senselessly shot up his neighborhood, he's dead. Not a game, it's not a video, it's not coming back, it's real bullets kill children. So that's hard to convey to a mom who's heartbroken and shell-shocked. And sadly, I've talked to a lot of moms in this situation. And frequently the day after, they don't really know how to be or what to say or what they need. But I can say that she knows that the city hurts with her and is with her, and we're gonna do all that we can to help her. Yes.
Mayor Bowser, you made the point that that there's no magic solution in a budget to gun violence. What would you say to people who wanna use this incident to argue against cuts to police budget, against cuts to the police budget?
I'm sorry, Bennett, could you give me that again?
What would you say to people who want to use this incident, what happened over the weekend, the killing of Davon, to fight back against the council's proposal to cut from the MPD budget?
Well, there are a lot of reasons to fight back against that. But I think that you've heard, and we frequently see, when there is such a attack on a community, on a family, on a child, that people want the police to do something about it. And I don't think that's gonna change, whether their budget is cut or not. There'll just be fewer of them to do it. Any other questions, Mark?
Mayor Bowser and Dr. Nesbitt, I'm wondering if, one, you guys can kind of talk about the spike and give us a little bit of details about the spike that you reported today. And also, Mayor Bowser, just your thoughts about Virginia, particularly Northern Virginia, moving into phase three today. If you have expressed, if you have concerns, and if so, if you've expressed them to the governor of Virginia.
And Mark, if I could just ask, and I'm going to turn it over to Dr. Nesbitt to talk about a new peak in the district. And we don't refer to it as a spike, because I think when you hear spikes from other places, it's because numbers have shot up through the roof. You know how we measure a change in a peak. So I don't want to give the impression to your listeners when they hear spike that it's a huge number of new cases, because that's not the case. But the experience that we've seen with the cases suggests that we have a different peak, and we use that new peak to manage days of decline in cases. So I just want to make that clear. In regards to Virginia, I am pleased that I think they're still in the posture of not having bars open. And I continue to hope that they remain in that posture.
Hi, I honestly don't have more to add than the mayor. And as we've discussed here several times, we don't have a spike when we talk about our trend as we measure the decline in new cases. What we report to you every day in terms of the number of new reported cases, we then match that against our decline in new cases, which are mapped on a graph that shows when those cases occurred based on their symptom onset or their estimated period of infection. So today, the number of new reported cases that we are reporting out, those 33 cases, have to go on a graph about their symptom onset or period of estimated infection. And so that will adjust that period of decline. So the peak number of cases aren't related to, as I've stated here on a number of occasions, the 33 or the 44, et cetera. So it would be erroneous to say that 33 cases reported today represents a spike in cases, or us having to adjust the new peak date from back on the 22nd that we previously reported out, or last week when we had to reset, or resetting today, representing a spike in cases as some other states are experiencing, with the total number of people in their community being infected. So that's why we encourage you to actually look at the dashboard, which is why we published the dashboard, to be able to follow along. And it's again, these things are complicated statistical and epi perspectives. Our take-home message for people is protect yourself, protect others, wear a mask, keep 6 feet of distance, and choose your activities wisely. We also want people to understand that when we feel it's appropriate for us to turn on new activities, we're going to make those recommendations to the mayor and then advise when it's appropriate to move into phase three.
Yes, Savannah.
So the widespread demonstrations, that started in early June, and we're about 4 weeks after that, and we haven't really seen a significant spike in cases since then. Is it too early to say if these protests are a significant source of transmission, or does that data show you that it wasn't a significant source of transmission?
Well, you've laid it out perfectly. You know how many weeks it's been. We continue to have them, so it's kind of a rolling 3 weeks. At the start of it, I think Dr. Nesbitt was interested in saying, well, I shouldn't think, but Dr. Nesbitt will say what she was interested in saying. Sorry.
Talking too much.
So what some observations have stated is when you see a change in the public health, the epidemiologic conditions in your community, it could take about 20 days to see that those changes reflected in your data. Different jurisdictions had different experiences with mass gatherings. In the district, we have not seen or heard our new cases report that their exposures being associated with mass gatherings, but other activities. We continue to monitor that. And so we have not been heretofore able to associate mass gatherings with our particular new cases. That being said, as the mayor has highlighted, we continue to have mass gatherings, so it does not allow us to exclude mass gatherings as a potential option or source of exposure here in the District of Columbia. So we continue to monitor that. So from a public health perspective, we cannot definitively exclude mass gatherings.
What are the biggest sources of exposure you're seeing with the new cases?
Oh, we continue to see household contacts as a source of exposure, as well as essential activities as a source of exposure, and other activities that are coming online. Because the district has had a slow phased reopening, we don't have the high risk exposures that other places have had, such as bars and nightclubs, et cetera, showing up in our data, which may contribute to us being in the posture that we are in versus other communities.
Okay, Mark?
Mayor Bowser, can we switch to sports and get your thoughts on, there's a lot of momentum now around the Washington NFL franchise name change, both from corporations and now we're hearing from minority ownership. What are your thoughts about how this is moving and whether it's moving in a direction where it makes it easier to find this team back in Washington, D.C.?
Well, there's a lot in that question, Mark. And first, I am happy to see the team and the league moving in the direction to change the name. And I hope they make clear what the process is to do that. You also mentioned, and I think we all read this morning, that there's some of the ownership that's looking to get out of the franchise. And I actually think this would also be a great opportunity for the team in the league to look for more diversity in their ownership. And I hope that they will make that a part of their discussion if there's actually going to be some transfers in ownership. And lastly, I think that the team called Washington Anything should be playing in Washington. And this certainly, I think there would be a lot of issues. So I would hardly say that the name is the only issue that would have the team or Washington choose to have a stadium. All right, last question.
We've heard some anecdotal reports of 7 to 10 day waits for coronavirus test results. What does the data show about what the wait time for getting test results back is, are? And is that a significant problem?
Well, it's one that we monitor very closely, and Dr. Nesbitt and DOH would really like to minimize, as I'm sure you know, for their contact tracing efforts, having those test results as quickly as possible from the test date makes all of our other work more effective. Let me ask Chris Rodriguez to talk to you about our experience with turnaround times for our publicly supported labs, testing sites.
Yep, thanks for the question, Fennett. On average, our test result turnaround time is about 3 to 5 days. We can't rule out the possibility that there are, from time to time, residents or individuals that wait longer than that. But generally speaking, our turnaround time is 3 to 5 days.
And we did have early on in our opening up fire stations and following the big demonstrations at the beginning, we had an influx of tests, and probably if there were people who experienced longer wait times than that, it was around those sampling collection dates. All right, thank you, everybody.